Good morning, everybody, and welcome to this evening, morning's program. It gives me great pleasure to have you all here in this room for the UK-India Strategic Dialogue on Opportunity and Security in a Changing World. And to begin this dialogue, we have with us the Right Honourable Sir Michael Fallon, Secretary of State of Defence, UK, who will help us kick off the event with a keynote address. So welcome, sir, at the Observer Research Foundation. For our audience, just briefly, Sir Michael Fallon was the MP from Darlington for 9 years, 83 to 92, and has held several portfolios in the British government, including as Minister in the Department of Education and Science. He also has been Deputy Chairman of the Conservative Party. Sir Michael was appointed Minister for Business and Enterprise in September 2012 and Minister of State for Energy in March 2013. And since July 2014, Sir Michael has been the UK Defence Secretary. Now, in his current role, Sir Michael leads the British government's strategic operations, defence planning, and management of strategic international partnerships, along with other responsibilities. Sir, it is my absolute pleasure to welcome you here. Britain is and will continue to remain an important defence partner for India. The bilateral programme of exercises, exchanges, and high-level visits across all three services continues apace between the UK and India. Defence equipment cooperation today covers, amongst other areas, the supply of AW101 helicopters and Hawk advanced jet trainers. Maritime security is again another key Indian aspiration in the Indian Ocean, as well as New Delhi works with other like-minded countries to make sure the region remains stable and sea lanes of communication remain open. So substantive maritime cooperation between the Indian and British navies, as well as both governments for creative normative regimes, can be an area of engagement that we can look forward in the future. But primed for cooperation between India and the UK is the manufacture of naval platforms, such as surface vessels, destroyers, frigates, aircraft carriers, subsurface platforms, and UK-India collaboration, the manufacture of subsystems, such as electronic warfare systems, and sea-based heli-borne platforms are also areas of potential collaboration. During the UK visit of Prime Minister Narendra Modi in November 2015, the two nations agreed to strengthen ties on defence and counter-terrorism efforts. Internal security is a definite focus area at a time when India seeks assistance in strengthening its domestic intelligence and policing apparatus, in building capacities, and Britain can play an important role on this count by sharing expertise and best practices, as well as help in capacity building. Even as big ticket manufacturing and R&D defense deals do capture the headlines from time to time, you know, both when winning them or losing them, but a force multiplier for India-UK ties and for India's national security will be the strengthening of capacities in areas such as counterterrorism and low intensity conflicts. It is worth noting that the declaration signed during Indian Prime Minister's UK visits specifically refers to organizations like Lashkar-e-Taiba, Hizbul Mujahideen, the Haqqani Network, and underscores the need for the two countries to work together to disrupt financial and tactical support for terrorist networks, including the Islamic State and the Al-Qaeda. Cybersecurity has also emerged as a priority area. India needs to build its capacity in this realm, and the UK can provide world-class expertise, education, and training to India's cybersecurity professionals. The two countries have agreed to expand the UK's Chevening Cyber Scholarships Program for India and establish a cybersecurity training center of excellence. In fact, ORF coordinates a 2-year national capacity building workshop on cybersecurity for India's law enforcement agencies, thanks to the generous support of the Foreign and Commonwealth Office. The two governments have elevated the defense relationship with more joint military exercises and cooperation on technology and defense manufacturing. It is now time to take the UK-India strategic partnership up a notch through the creation of a joint vision for the bilateral defense relationships, as well as India-UK efforts to craft a shared agenda for the stability of common spaces in the region. The present government of India is keen to build indigenous defense manufacturing capacities and gradually convert the world's largest arms importer into a heavyweight manufacturer. In pursuit of this objective, it has raised the cap in foreign investment, including allowing complete ownership of defense projects. In 2013, you will recall the then British Prime Minister David Cameron made a push for the sale of Eurofighter Typhoon fighter jets for the Indian Air Force. The bid may not have materialized, but it did sensitize India's policymakers of the need to diversify the country's defense procurement. The magnitude of the contract and subsequent conversations around its implementation was also a reminder to India that it must invest in defense R&D to sustain its appetite for building a robust national security architecture. So can British and Indian institutions, research centers, universities, private and public enterprises collaborate and commercially scale R&D innovations for the Indian defense market? India's renewed focus on seeding indigenous defense technology is reflected in its agreements with international partners on co-production and co-development of defense platforms. So this is one opportunity and a big opportunity that awaits us. The strategic dialogue is a platform to take stock of our current engagements, recommend ways to make them more robust, and identify frontier areas of cooperation that will drive the relationship forward. And we, as the Observer Research Foundation, are delighted to be convening the dialogue and to host this August gathering right in this room. So I welcome all of you again to this day's discussions. With that, I would like to invite Sir Michael Fallon, Secretary of State for Defense, to deliver his keynote address to start the proceedings. Over to you, sir.
Well, thank you for that introduction, and I'm delighted to be here at the Foundation to kick off this dialogue. The title of this session is The UK Experience, the Indian Requirement. I think we should reverse the order of that. What is India's requirement, and how does UK experience fit in? It is no secret that your Prime Minister is keen for your government and your Ministry of Defence to undergo a radical transformation process, looking at structural devolution, rationalisation, and commercialisation. So it seems to me, as you here in India now consider whether appointing a permanent Chief of Defence Staff is appropriate for the Indian Armed Forces, as you look to set up a new procurement agency, it seems to me there are great opportunities to share our transformation journey. The United Kingdom has already been down this road. We have some scars on our back to prove it, and it may be helpful for you to hear a little of our experience, to find out what worked for us, or more importantly, perhaps, to learn from some of the mistakes that we made. So I want to share with you today a little of the story of how we implemented one of the biggest defence transformation programmes in the Western world. So let me set the context for you. When I came into politics, our ordnance was publicly owned. Our warship building was owned by a public corporation. Our aerospace industry was publicly owned. Our procurement programmes were publicly directed. 7 years ago, when our government first came to office in the coalition, we were looking at a £38 billion black hole in the defence programme of equipment that had been programmed, but that was not being properly financed. And behind that lay a defence that was a mess, relationships that were dysfunctional, focused on short-term affordability at the expense of longer-term planning, compounded by self-defeating competition for resources between the three services. Now, we didn't just feel the effect of all that in our pockets. Projects regularly ran over time. Contracts produced suboptimal outcomes, with the penalty for going over budget largely shouldered by the taxpayer. And most damaging of all, we ended up with a dangerous inability to get the right equipment to the right place on time. Faced with all of that, our response had to be and was wide-ranging defence reform. First, in the short term, about realising immediate financial savings. That wasn't easy. Back in 2010, it involved making trade-offs and some tough choices. We had to scrap some much-loved capabilities, like HMS Ark Royal. We had to cancel some procurement programs, like the Nimrod Maritime Patrol aircraft. We had to sort out the rebasing of our troops, and we had to adjust the size of our armed forces without compromising their frontline clout. Second, we focused on the medium term. We set about renegotiating dozens of contracts, reducing the costs of our major projects by hundreds of millions of pounds. And we looked too at ways of maximising our assets. The defence estate in the United Kingdom is vast. It's almost 2% of the United Kingdom's land mass. We own more land than Her Majesty the Queen. But it is also outdated and inefficient. The private sector, of course, you pay interest on the capital you borrow to invest. The private sector has an incentive not to hoard assets. Yet with assets worth over 120 billion, with 40% of our built assets more than 50 years old, and with the need to spend 2.5 billion a year simply to maintain that asset portfolio, we had a pretty strong reason to seek out the efficiencies we needed. Not least because of an agreement with our Treasury that every single one of those efficiency savings would go not to the Treasury, but back to us to be recycled into frontline investment. So we began by asking ourselves some pretty tough questions. Did we need 57 separate sites in and around Greater London? What was the right number of airfields and army bases for the armed forces of our size? Why did the Ministry of Defence own more than a dozen golf courses? And having looked at our portfolio, we then took action. Last year, we published a Better Estate strategy, creating a 21st century base for our armed forces, consolidating our estate into hubs of capability, selling off surplus land and barracks and buildings we no longer needed, but ensuring those sites were used too to build homes, support jobs, and fire up local economies. We released an airfield in Wiltshire to Dyson Technology to build their new technology research centre that they could have built anywhere in the world. We sold super hangars in Wales to Aston Martin for their new sports car model. But the third and final part of our plan was by far the most ambitious. It was about the long term. Those familiar with the Ministry of Defence in Britain know that we're no strangers to change programmes. We've had them before, but they've seldom had the lasting impact that we were looking for. To make our organisation not just match fit, but permanently fit, meant radically transforming our ministry's culture. And that's where, to return to the title of your session, the role of the private sector kicked in. We have, since 2010, employed the private sector in a whole variety of ways, adapting our response to suit the situation and to meet the sheer complexity of our organisation. So we've begun by importing that commercial mentality, turning our ministry into a more intelligent customer, devolving our budgets to the frontline commands, making the service chiefs effectively chief executives of multi-billion pound businesses. And by giving them far greater control over their spending and their outputs, they suddenly had a vested interest in knowing not just the cost, but the value of everything that they bought. And they know too that they can be and are held to account for their performance. And at the same time as giving the three frontline services that devolved responsibility, we created Joint Forces Command as the glue that binds the capabilities of our single services together. Then we went on to streamline our head office, reducing our headcount by 25% and getting rid of much of the red tape that bedevils any big bureaucracy. We also recognized that our armed forces were doing too much of the things that other organizations, other companies could do for them. We didn't want our armed forces running a raft of administrative services that could be better handled by professional companies. We want our armed forces to concentrate entirely on military effect. So we brought in strategic partners to get to grips with our sprawling defense property estate. We signed a contract to save a total of £3 billion over 10 years to make wholesale changes to the way in which we occupy the space that we've decided to retain. If you come now to my ministry in the center of Whitehall in London, you will find the second floor occupied by an entirely different Whitehall department, the Department for Exiting the European Union. With all the money that we have saved through these changes, we can, of course, make improvements elsewhere. And one particular aspect of our modernization that I think would be of particular interest to you here is the changes we've made in procurement. Now, it's taken us a long, long time to improve our procurement procedures, to modernize our program, and we've had varying success with the different reforms. Several reviews into what was going wrong have all driven similar conclusions. In our procurement, there was a lack of clear boundaries between the military customer and defense equipment and support. The vast majority of our programs and costs had a tendency to spiral. So our solution here was to give our organization, defense equipment and support, to give it special trading status, to ensure a far more business-like relationship with its military customers, to make it a more effective counterpart to industry. We gave it its own board, its own chief executive, and we also gave it, although part of the public sector, significant flexibilities to recruit, reward, and manage staff along more commercial lines. Now, there are, of course, some bits of kit which, for reasons of national security, national sovereignty, have only one supplier, a situation in which some firms have been only too keen to take advantage of. So we have also reformed our single source procurement processes, setting up a new office as an independent regulator to ensure that any single source contracts do deliver proper value for money. And that office sets a baseline profit rate for the companies involved. Our contracts, too, now embrace a pain share, gain share element, ensuring that overruns on budget are passed not to the Ministry of Defence as previous, but are borne by the companies concerned. Now, none of that has been easy. It has taken us 4 or 5 years to get our defence finances back onto an even keel. But we now have the highest spending delegation of any ministry in Whitehall, and we are crucially able to serve up savings, all of them, to be reinvested into frontline capabilities. It is because of that that last year we were able for the first time to start growing our defence budget again, and it now grows year on year for the remainder of this Parliament right through to 2020, with an annual increase of some 0.5% ahead of inflation. And that means we now set out an investment programme totalling some £180 billion over the next 10 years to enable us to complete our new aircraft carriers, to deliver new frigates, new maritime patrol aircraft, F-35s, the Typhoons, the armoured vehicles, and the dreadnought nuclear submarines that our armed forces need. But while we run that investment programme, we believe we have now inculcated into defence a constant watchfulness, a desire, like any large organisation, to continue to look for savings and efficiencies and to continue to take out unnecessary cost. Now, we've benefited in the ministry from all that, but so too have the companies themselves. We spend around £20 billion a year with the defence industry. We support directly some 150,000 jobs in defence in the UK and many more thousands in their supply chains. But not only does that new approach to outsourcing open up new opportunities for small as well as large companies, but by becoming an intelligent customer, we have put the onus back on industry to reduce its overheads, to collaborate more between themselves, to improve their processes, and to become more efficient. And in particular, we have been able now to start encouraging them, large and small, to invest in the innovation that we need to help us create the disruptive capabilities that will enable us to retain our technological edge, to keep ahead of our adversaries, even as they become more sophisticated. Now, we're not alone in facing any of these challenges, and that is why we are keen to work more closely with international companies further afield, becoming more international by design. And that brings me back to our collaboration here in India. You can trace the history of our joint working all the way back through Hermes to Hawke. Today, we can point to Hindustan Aeronautics and BAE unveiling their advanced Hawke ground demonstrator at Aero India this year. We can look at Rolls-Royce working with a defence research and development organisation to create gas turbine technologies. Big development. But India and the United Kingdom also believe in better as well as bigger. So as India invites the world to come and make in this great country, as a global Britain spreads its wings, I believe we have an unprecedented opportunity now to accelerate that partnership between us. That's why, as you referred, Prime Minister Modi and David Cameron agreed the defence and international security partnership back at the end of 2015. It's why our current Prime Minister made sure her first bilateral visit outside the European Union was here to India. And it's why I'm here today, not just to see what more we can make in India, or make with India, but to see what more we can design, develop, add value with India, and export together to third countries and to new markets. How we can better match British experience with Indian brain power. Now, ultimately, the success of that future collaboration, of that ambition I've shared with you today, will rest on these new capability partnerships, the exciting collaborations underway on future gas turbine technologies. They will help us build the disruptive capability that can counter fifth generation threats. But we also need to look beyond equipment, and we will. These partnerships are also about our respective forces, our air forces training side by side, our Royal Navy learning from you on experience in working up new aircraft carriers as we regenerate our aircraft carrier strike. It's about our armies finding new ways to protect our troops as they go about their lawful business. It's about our security services, not just exchanging information on counter-terrorism, but joining forces to defuse fanatical propaganda and to protect impressionable young minds. So in the next 12 months, I want to see these capability partnerships really take off. There are a myriad of other areas where we can work profitably together. But I want to emphasize to you today that I'm here at this dialogue, not just to pass on our experience, but to better understand, as the title of your session suggests, your requirements. What is it that India really wants? What is it that you in this room are looking for? Because I know that while individually, India has so much to offer and Britain has so much to offer, if we can put the two together, we can be world beaters. Thank you.
I'm Devin Verma and I'm from Silicon Valley. The question is how UK is seeing India as a co-partner in the high technology development area.
Thank you.
That's the question.
Thank you.
Well, thank you for that question. And that does go to the heart of what I was trying to address, which is that we should be thinking of India not just as a market for British companies, but as a launch pad where we can develop high-tech capabilities and sell them to third countries, and in particular sell them into new markets. And that's why I put the focus not simply on manufacture. It's important, of course, to make and have the value for employment and other industry and the supply chains that comes from manufacture. But it's also important that we work together to design, to develop these technologies, to use the best of Indian brain power against the expertise of our long-established defense companies to create the new products, the new high-tech products that the rest of the world is looking for. Now, that is my vision from this collaboration. And that means looking at some of these very promising areas in the new technologies, looking at autonomous systems, for example, looking at supercomputers, how we handle big data, looking at the various techniques that we're going to need in the new era of electronic warfare, and seeing whether we can develop the capabilities that keep us ahead of our adversaries.
So, Kanchan Gupta. Yeah.
So you spoke about cooperation and getting a sense of what India wants. I'm sure you really have a sense of what India wants by now. One of the things that India wants is technology transfer in, you know, when you go into Make in India. So are you considering serious technology transfer, or are you still holding back on that and just wanting to use India's technological brain power?
No, the answer is we're deadly serious about that. The Prime Minister emphasized in her initial visit the need for us to transfer technology. If you look at the financial sector, the Chancellor made exactly the same point in his visit here last week. We have looked again at, for example, our export controls, our licensing system. I note that I think around 99% of these license applications are granted. We are looking again now at how we can further facilitate the transfer of that technology. We're looking at a government-to-government framework now that can embrace the way that we share technology. And that will be one of the specific areas under the Defence an international security partnership under the DISP that we are now taking forward in our consultative group, our working group, that is headed by the permanent secretary of my ministry and his opposite number here in Delhi.
Madhulika, young researcher from ORF.
Thank you, Sir Fallon, for your speech. Our prime ministers last year agreed on working together to promote a free and secure cyberspace. I was wondering how our countries could cooperate on issues of online radicalization and cybercrime. Thank you.
Well, thank you. I think this is one of the most important, you know, security areas, and it is covered by the security partnership that we are developing. We have to protect our key institutions. We have to protect our own defense. We have to protect our critical national infrastructure. We have to protect our companies from cyber attacks. But above all, as you said, we have to protect ourselves against the threat from extremism in poisoning young minds. And we have to work together on that. We have now a dialogue between India and our new National Cyber Security Center that brings together all the work done by our different ministries in London. And we are opening up access to the work done at GCHQ to the Indian services as well. Because this is now a global issue. And those of us who champion these values of tolerance and democracy, none of us now are exempt from the need to confront and call out extremism and do what we can to ensure that that poison doesn't enter the bloodstream of our younger, more impressionable people. So this is an area in which we are going to be working ever more closely, and in meetings later today, I shall be reviewing what further progress we can make, particularly in cooperation between our two security services.
Can I now go to the back there to Geeta Mohan? Who else?
A very good morning. I'd like to focus on the security in a changing world aspect of Indo-UK strategic dialogue. You would be meeting with your counterpart tomorrow. Wanted to know about the terrorism aspect of the relations between India and the United Kingdom, particularly India's concerns regarding terrorism emanating from Pakistan. Also, the recent developments on what Pakistan has done to an ex-naval officer by sending him to the gallows without having informed India, violating all international norms.
Well, good morning to you. Thank you for that. Thank you. Sorry. Good morning to you, and thank you for that question. Terrorism, of course, is high on our agenda, and we've seen, sadly, in recent weeks that no country is immune from terrorism. I recall the pipe bomb attack on one of your trains. You will have seen the attack on Westminster, close to our own, the heart of our democracy, the needless killing of foreign tourists in London, the attack in St. Petersburg, the attack in Egypt just 2 days ago. No country is immune from terrorism, and we have to work ever harder, more closely together to combat it. We are doing that here in India, working with your authorities, and my schedule over the next couple of days includes more meetings to review that. And we do the same as British government with every country in the world, encouraging them to develop the ways in which they fight terrorism, to take responsibility for terrorism that when they come across it within their borders, and to deal with it more effectively. I'm not able to comment on the particular case that that you've drawn my attention to.
And the final intervention this morning is from Stefania, again, next to Geeta there.
Thank you. Good morning. My name is Stefania Benaglia. I'm an associate fellow based in Delhi of the Italian Institute of Affari Internazionali. Considering that in addition to the well-established defense industry, such as Russia, the US, and Israel, the global competition is witnessing the rise of China and possibly in the future of India. The EU on its side adopted last December an ambitious package covering aspects of capability development and military research. How do you envisage the UK to maintain its prominent role in the global defense industry in the next 15 to 20 years? Thank you.
That's a very big question. Let me try an answer to it. At the moment, we have the second biggest defense sales in the world. We have a very successful defense industry, and we aim to keep it there. Although there is, as you've said, competition all the time from countries developing their defense businesses. I like to think that we have founded that success on a more competitive home market by the more rigorous procurement processes that we've introduced in our ministry that has made our defense companies in turn leaner and fitter to operate not just in the British market, but leaner and fitter when they go out to win export sales across the world. And that's the point I want to reemphasize again and again. I see these capability partnerships not just improving the equipment we need for our armed forces, or improving the way in our respective budgets we allocate our resources more effectively, but creating the platforms that we can develop jointly to be able to sell into third markets, to sell to new countries that we've not previously had success in before. That's my ambition for the partnership that we're now developing.
Excellent. So before we close this session, it's my privilege and honor to propose a vote of thanks. Thank you, sir, for joining us this morning, for kickstarting what we believe would be a series of discussions over the next few years. The ORF hosts India's flagship foreign policy and security policy event called the Raisina Dialogue. And as one of the sub-forums in 2017, in August, we proposed to create a defense technology and security forum, where, of course, we will have a conversational and a platform element, but we propose to have a day-long closed-door conversation based on which we intend to produce advisories to answer the question you have posed before us this morning. What are India's requirements? What do we need for ourselves? What is the kind of financial innovation we need to be engaged in? Can we become intelligent customers, borrowing a phrase from your speech? Can we use the private sector well? How do we deal with situations around single vendors? What do we do about cost overruns? All elements that you covered in your exposition this morning. But I think one of the critical inputs in the relationship would certainly be your seven-year-old journey of transforming your defense sector and your defense institutions. And I think if we can learn from your mistakes and your successes, that would be valuable to India's own journey over the coming years. So please join me in applauding the minister for his exposition this morning. And thank you so much for joining us.